I am Dr. Seema Wirtz, and today we'll be discussing about motion of rigid bodies part 2. In this part 2, the following objectives are to be followed. First, the theorem of parallel axis and perpendicular axis. Secondly, we'll be defining torque and find the direction of rotation produced by it. We'll also be discussing about principle of conservation of angular momentum and calculate the velocity acquired by a rigid body at the end of its motion on an inclined plane. Let's see what is the moment of inertia in this different shapes and different axes that the bodies are having. First, let's take up an example of hoop, and we take a hoop rotation about a central axis, that is an axis that is passing through the center of the hoop. The moment of inertia for this is given by I is equal to mr square. Similarly, we can take up an annular cylinder or a ring, and the cylindrical axis has been chosen as the rotational axis. The value of moment of inertia comes out to be I is equal to m by 2 in brackets r1 square plus r2 square. Then we have an example of solid cylindrical shape object in which the cylindrical axis is taken as the moment of inertia that we are calculating about the rotational axis, and the value of moment of inertia comes out to be I is equal to mr square by 2. For the solid cylinder, if we take out the value of moment of inertia about an axis that is passing through the central diameter, we get the value as I is equal to mr square by 4 plus ml square by 12. Now we are going to find out the moment of inertia in the rod in which the axis is passing through the center and normal to its length. The value of moment of inertia comes out to be I is equal to ml square by 12. Similarly, if the thin rod has an axis passing through one of the end and perpendicular to the length, then we have the moment of inertia as ml square by 3. If we take a solid sphere and the rotational axis is about diameter, then I is equal to 2 by 5 mr square. We also observe that when we calculate the moment of inertia of a thin spherical shell about an axis passing through any of the diameter, we get the moment of inertia as 2 by 3 mr square. Similarly, moment of inertia for a hoop where axis is passing about any diameter is given by mr square by 2, and the moment of inertia for a hoop when the axis is passing through a tangent line is given by 3 by 2 mr square. Now we'll discuss about the theorems of moment of inertia. There are two theorems which connects moment of inertia about two axes, one of which is passing through the center of mass of the body. First theorem is theorem of parallel axis, and the second theorem is theorem of perpendicular axis. Now theorem of parallel axis. The moment of inertia about an axis parallel to the axis passing through its center of mass is equal to the moment of inertia about its center of mass plus the product of mass and square of the perpendicular distance between the parallel axis. That is, I is equal to IC plus MD square, where I denotes the required moment of inertia. IC is the moment of inertia about a parallel axis passing through the CM, and m is the mass of the body and d is the distance between the two axes. Let's talk about the theorem of perpendicular axis. For this, take a lamina in which there is three axes x, y, z, and when we have to calculate the moment of inertia of a hoop, we have the hoop is being denoted by a circle. There are two values, that is id, that is a moment of inertia about a diameter which is passing through the center of the circle is given as id. When we rotate it by an angle 90 degree, again we have a diameter which is given by id. So iz is equal to ix plus iy according to theorem of perpendicular axis. The perpendicular axis theorem states that the sum of the moment of inertia about x and y axis is equal to the moment of inertia about the z axis. Take an example of hoop. That is, the moment of inertia of a hoop about an axis passing through its center and perpendicular to the base is given by mr square, where m is its mass and r is its radius. According to theorem of perpendicular axis, this must be equal to the sum of moment of inertia about the two diameters which are perpendicular to each other as well as to the central axis. The moment of inertia of a hoop is given by Iz is equal to Ix plus Iy. Iz is given by mr square, while Ix is equal to Iy, which is given by twice of Id. Since the moment of inertia about each diameter is same, that is Id, therefore the moment of inertia of a hoop about any of its diameter is given by mr square by 2. Let's talk about torque and couple. The question arises, what is the analog of force in the case of rotational motion? To look into this, consider the example of opening and closing of a door. A door is a rigid body which can rotate about a fixed vertical axis passing through the hinges. What makes the door rotate? Well, can any force rotate the door? No, any force does not rotate the door. A force applied on hinges does not rotate the door, but the force applied at the right angles to the door at the outer edges is most effective in producing the rotation. This is a point that is to be noted. It is not the force alone, but how and where the force is applied is important in rotational motion. And the rotational analog of force is the moment of force. It is also referred to as torque or couple. The turning effect of a force is called as torque. Now, we will discuss about the torque by taking an example of a body, rigid body, and rotating it by angle of theta. For this, let's take up the figure that is shown on the board. This is a body which is a lamina we have taken, and there is a point which is being fixed, that is a nail has been put on this thing. A body can be rotated by applying a force. We are applying a force that is at a point A. So, we can see that when we join the action of the force line, that is A, it goes up to B, and then there is a distance S between O and B. So, between the fixed point O and along the force which is being applied along this action line AB, there is a distance S. While between the fixed point O and the force applied at a point A, this is called as a distance R. The question is, if we apply the same force here, that is at a point O, will it be rotate the body? What we notice that when the force is applied here, no rotation occurs. But certainly, when a force is applied at a point A, the body rotates. What is the reason for this? Since torque is given by F into S, that is the force applied and the distance between the line of action and the fixed point. But this S, it can be seen it is equal to R sine theta. So, we have tau is equal to R cross F, because R cross F, when we remove the cross, we have R F sine theta. This means, this is a special significance, this carries a special significance. Why? Because now the torque has a direction perpendicular to the plane containing R and F. The unit of torque is Newton meter. Now what happens? There are two cases when the torque is zero and when the torque is maximum. That is, in this case, you can see when the torque is zero, the theta is equal to zero. That is, there is this theta, it is zero between the point that is we are taking, and tau is equal to zero. When the theta is 90 degree, we have tau is equal to Rf and it has the maximum value. Therefore, we have also gained that there is a right hand thumb rule in which the direction of torque is given by this thumb, and there is R and F plane. If they are rotating, this direction gives the direction of the torque. We can take up another example. Here, we have taken a laminar body. We apply force, that is two equal and opposite force. This is in the right direction and this is in the left direction. There is another point to be noticed, that the line of action is different. that it has been applied at this point B, and this force has been applied at point A. This lamina has been fixed up at a point O. There is a difference in the distance, that is, where the point F is applied at B, it is at a distance A from the point that is O, and force that is being applied at point A, it is at a distance A plus B. So, according to our definition of torque, torque is given by F S, that is the force applied and the distance between the axis of rotation and the action on line. Therefore, we have tau 1, that is tau 1 is given by for this force as A plus B F. Why? Because the distance is A plus B. While for torque 2, that is for this thing, we have the distance being A and then we have F. So, it is equal to F. We will calculate the net torque applied on this lamina. This is equal to tau is equal to tau 1 minus tau 2. What do we get? We get Bf. Therefore, the magnitude of net torque is in the direction of the larger torque. That is, there it is a larger torque, here it is a smaller torque. Therefore, the net torque is applied in the direction of the larger torque. Also, we have two equal and opposite forces acting on a body having different line of action, it forms a couple, and couple whose torque is given by this value. Now, we will also consider to explain more about the value of torque in terms of angular acceleration. Let's consider a rigid body rotating about an axis passing through the point O. Let's take up this as a point O. Here is an interesting thing. We take up a particle P on this lamina. When this body is rotating about this point O, about this axis OA, then this particle P is rotating about an axis in a circle of a radius R. Again, if the motion is non-uniform, that is, the circular motion is not uniform, then there are two forces being applied on the body. First, the radial force that is being applied in this direction, and then the tangential force which is applied in this direction, that is tangent to the circle. This radial force, it does not produce torque, again because theta is equal to 0, and it is equal to the centripetal force of attraction, which is always attracted toward the center, given by the value mr omega square. While the tangential force which is responsible for the change in the velocity is given by ma, because the change in the velocity with time will give you acceleration. A is called as tangential acceleration, and it is again related to angular acceleration by r alpha. Alpha is the angular acceleration and r is the distance between the particle and the axis of the rotation. Therefore, we are saying that the torque is equal to the force, that is the tangential force, into the distance, that is r. It is given by mi ri square alpha. Again, we know that the expression summation mi r square represents moment of inertia. Therefore, the torque is given by I alpha. Hence, I is the moment of inertia, alpha is the angular acceleration produced, and torque is related to both of them by this expression. Let's talk about angular momentum. Get hold of a stool which rotates without friction. Now, measure the speed of the stool when a person with arms folded sits on it and rotates. Also measure the speed when the person rotates with the arms stretched. We notice that the stool moves with a greater angular velocity in the first case, that is, in which the person sits with the arm folded. And the product of the linear momentum and the distance from the axis is called as angular momentum, denoted by L. L is equal to I omega, where omega is the angular velocity and I is the moment of inertia. The angular velocity omega is same for all the particles and I is the moment of inertia. Above equation gives only component of vector L along the axis of rotation. The unit of angular momentum is kilogram meter square second inverse. Let's talk about the conservation of angular momentum. First, we should know that the rate of change of angular momentum is equal to torque. That is, dl by dt is equal to torque. Since torque is equal to I omega, therefore we have I d omega by dt, which is again equal to I alpha, where alpha is angular acceleration. What happens if dl by dt is equal to 0? That is, torque is equal to 0, which means that no torque is acting on the body. This means that there is no change in L and angular momentum remains constant. This is called as the principle of conservation of angular momentum. Let's talk about the examples of conservation of angular momentum. The first example is when the person rotates with the hand folded, then the moment of inertia decreases because the distribution of mass decreases and the angular velocity increases. Why? Why the angular velocity increases? Because according to the law of conservation of momentum, L is equal to I omega. So, if the moment of inertia decreases, then angular velocity increases to keep the angular momentum constant and conserved. Another example is that the length of the day is not constant. And what are the factors responsible for this? Well, the earth is rotating about its axis and its moment of inertia changes because there is a change in the distribution of mass of air, which happens due to changes in the weather. So, angular velocity changes due to change in the moment of inertia, and since L is equal to I omega, so the length of the day changes. Let's talk about simultaneous rotational and translational motions. For this, imagine a motion of an automobile wheel on a plane horizontal surface. We see a circular face, and when we fix our attention on a point C and P, we notice that point P rotates around the point C when the wheel rotates. Well, the point C itself gets translated in the direction of the motion. So, wheel has both translational and rotational motion. If point C or center of mass gets translated with velocity Vcm, the kinetic energy of translation is given by kinetic energy translation is equal to half mvcm square, where m is the mass, and if omega is the angular speed of the rotation, then the kinetic energy of rotation can be written as kinetic energy rotation is equal to I omega square by 2, where I is the moment of inertia. So, the total energy of the body due to translation and rotation is the sum of two kinetic energies. Let's talk about the secret of pulses. It's an interesting example of the conservation of angular momentum. The stars send pulses of radiation of great intensity towards us because stars are rotating very fast. The time period for the pulse received range from a few milliseconds to few seconds. The stars that we are talking of consist of neutrons and they rotate very fast because of their tiny size. The radius of the neutron star is 10 kilometers. While the radius of sun is 7 into 10 raised to the power 5 kilometer and it rotates about its axis with a period of 25 days. Imagine that now sun suddenly shrinks to the size of neutron star without any change in its mass. In order to conserve its angular momentum, the sun will have to rotate with a period as short as fraction of millisecond because now its distribution of mass has changed. It has been shrinked, that is the radius decreases. So, now let's see what we have learnt in this chapter. We have learnt about the turning effect of force on a rigid body, which is given by torque. Two equal and opposite forces constitute a couple. The magnitude of turning effect of torque is equal to the product of one of the forces and the perpendicular distance between the line of action of forces. The application of an external torque changes the angular momentum of the body. And when no net torque acts on a body, the angular momentum of the body remains constant. Thank you.